first time that we're having to do this mandatory recount, which is based on a legislative bill that was out last year by State Rep Mitch Greenlick. And the bill was written up so that it is a way to double-check and ensure that the tally machines are counting correctly. Depending on how close the race is, and I use that word because the tighter it is, the more precincts we have to count. That's basically how the bill is written. Five precincts were chosen, and out of those, the largest is 2,600 ballots returned, and the smallest one is about 100, and a little over 100. Once they get their precinct, their first part of their tour is really sorting. Because like the president's race, we have not just the two major candidates, but we have three or four minor candidates on there too. So if the tables had to start sorting, there's just no room. There is no room to put six candidates plus a write-in space, plus an overvote space, or an undervote space, meaning overvote is if somebody marked more than two or more spots. Undervote is if they marked nothing on it. So you have to have every contingency on the table. So like I said, the president's race was fairly large. So they went through several renditions of sorting that down. So let's say I have two stacks, and I'll use this really simply. It's two candidates. I have this stack here for candidate A and candidate B. You take candidate B and you start counting one through whatever. I'll take candidate A and I'll count mine. And I come up with a number. I could share it with you or I don't have to share it with you. I'll put it down on a piece of paper so I won't forget, and then we swap. And then I'll count your stack and then you'll count my stack, and hopefully the numbers match. And if the numbers match, then it's good to go on to the next.
Okay.
I always considered myself a citizen that believes in the importance of being politically active. We have great freedom here in America to participate in elections and be democratic. And so that just interests me for quite a while. And then when I became 18, I celebrated the fact that I could vote. And for my first election, I actually wrote to each one of the candidates and asked them for their personal views. And it was most of them wrote back. It was just a local election. But most of them wrote back to me and gave me personal answers for what they believed in. And from that, I selected who I wanted to vote for.
I was born in California. I moved up here 40 years ago, and I got involved in a lot of things. One of them is government and how it runs in the county and the city. I live in a house rural. I have two houses that I'm a landlord in the city, so I'm very busy. I also am involved in elections. I do a lot of campaigning for candidates. My girlfriend and I probably did 10,000 flyers this last election period. And election is the backbone of what happens to all of us.
A year ago, I heard about the Office of Precinct Committee Person, which is basically the lowest level of government that there is. It's grassroots government. And somebody told me about it, and they told me that each precinct here in Oregon, in my precinct, there were six slots open. And I remembered in years past that very few people had ran, so I decided to run. And there were six slots, and three people ran, so by default, I was elected. And so I became involved in the political party that I was elected to. And then while I was there, they were taking volunteers to come and help ensure voter integrity by monitoring ballot counting, and I volunteered. The numbers that they're off, they're going to recount after lunch. So they're going to go back, even though they counted it four times and their numbers came up different, they're going to go back and recount it. And then probably the difference they were saying was in ballots, like somebody marked it twice or something. like one ballot I saw where somebody voted for both John McCain and Chuck Baldwin for president. And so that was kind of a, that's one of the places where they had an error between the machine count and the hand count.
What did the machine count out as?
The machine threw it out.
Okay.
And they considered it a vote for John McCain.
Why?
Because it had a big X over the Chuck Baldwin vote. So a human looking at it, it made sense that John McCain was the one who was supposed to be voted for.
The machines do not count clean through a total precinct. It jams. And particularly if it's rainy, like today, and the ballots get moist.
Oh, right.
They constantly are blowing air into them and taking the ballots that the machine says didn't count and putting them back through. And it just looks really bad if you're not at that machine that can see exactly what's going on. So we're screaming our head off, you know. So, but this crew here is good. But a lot of them maybe are not, because they're not transparent the way they should be. Multnomah County puts you as far away as possible. And we just keep at our leaders.
Let's say it's a yes and a no. And I cross through the yes. Even if I circled it, I cross through it. So now I have two ovals that are circled, one with an X on it. And the first table, when they looked at this, decided that the person wanted to vote no, because the X has, the yes had the X. So that's how they're gonna cover up the yes. Meaning they're gonna put a tape over it so that it does not count, and the no will count. So that's the voter intent, that they saw that the ballot should count as. That's how it goes through.
To ensure that your vote is counted, if you fill in a bubble, and it should be with a black or a blue pen, not a pencil, and the bubble should be filled in completely, but if you do make a mistake, use whiteout, and whiteout the vote completely, so that there's no question as to what you really meant.
It's 2 o'clock in the morning, you're really tired, you don't see these double marks, so it gets pushed into the machine count group. So it goes through and the machine counts it. And what we have on every machine, and the 650 is a tally machine, we have overvote and blank vote tagged on. So if it comes through, the machine will see that and it'll stop. It'll tell the operator you have an overvote ballot. Our operators are all instructed to remove that and put it aside. And then the day after the election, this is the day after, they don't deal with it at all that night. The day after, because on election day you just have too much chaos and noise and commotion and just too much activity. So the operators put everything up on the top that doesn't get through. And then the next day we will take another board and they'll go through all the machine kickouts, is what we call them. They're not rejects, they're just machine kickouts, because we chose a machine. We told the machine, stop. We don't want you to count this. So now we'll have the board go through and say, oh yeah, they missed this one. I mean, when you have a huge ballot back in front, the boards are very likely to miss one way at the bottom here. I mean, the front may look perfect, but all of a sudden at the bottom you'll see somebody who changed their mind.
When we first started this review process, it was very hostile. And it has changed management now, and it's fine. Plus we repeatedly after elections go to the commissioners and tell them what they should be looking at. So we do our part before, during, and after, and we expect them to respond as our elected officials, and they have been. So it takes citizen involvement to keep elections clean.
The majority of the people in politics are generally, well, they're old, and there's very few young people, and I think it's a great chance for young people to come in and be trained by these older generation that have been in politics for years and learn how the ropes work.
And I'm really happy that the young people are getting involved, because I am one of the old people. And it's kind of nice to be able to pass it off to them with what we've learned. We had to start from scratch. And what we've learned and what we don't approve of, we take back to our county commissioners. And we have received improvements since we started. And we're all Republicans. Very few Democrats take time to be in this process. And so we get most of the spots because of the Democrats come, we have to share with space. And so when they don't show up, we just have more access to the process.
What do you think of the law that requires the hand count? I had talked to some folks that said initially the way it was written was really good, and they really agreed with it, and they thought it would be a really excellent oversight. But then by the time it became okay, it became a law, it had been watered down. Mm-hmm. So is doing this hand count, is it worthwhile? Is it going to actually give any statistical data that says... Mm-hmm. something important, or is it just for show?
I'm trying to remember the original bill when it came out, and I don't remember other than the fact that for some reason the way it was introduced or the way I heard it, it would have been extremely difficult because I think it wanted us to stop in the middle of counting. For some reason it rings a bell, and I could be off, totally off the rack on that one. The way the bill was introduced, it would have been extremely impractical to implement. And so I believe there were several discussions with Representative Mitch Greenlee on this, various discussions. And the final statute that did end up coming through was very similar to Minnesota's, I believe, or a couple of states have this same process in place. So I don't know if you would consider it watered down. I think it's very similar. If anything, I think this is going to be the trend that you see.
Tell me about the ESNS machines and the Unity machine part of it. How does it work? Are they connected to the internet? Is it?
No.
How do you secure them?
The Unity is a software program for the tabulator. The tabulator is pretty much, it's a dummy shell. It just sits there until we load the program from the Unity and then take it out of it. So ballots, Unity is where you program your ballot style. So you have ballot style one, just as a simple one. You can vote for this candidate, this candidate, this candidate, and it's on a grid. So the grid tells you at point, column A, line 10, you can vote for John McCain. Column A, line 20, you vote for Barack, kind of that, you know. So it's on a grid, and it goes A, B, C, and it has a column. You program ballot style 1 to read this way. Ballot style 2 may be a little bit different. Ballot style 3. So each time you have a ballot style, there's something different between 1, 2, and 3. You have all of this laid out. You load it into the optical scan, the 650s. And then when you start counting the numbers on them, it recognizes ballot style 1, and it says it should read this, this, and this. Ballot style 2 should read this, this, and this. And so it collects that data, and then it goes back into the Unity program. And then we just load the information in, meaning that it just collects the data from the ballot, and then it puts it in a report format.
And where does that go?
It doesn't really go anywhere. I mean, until we print it out or put it on a disk and take it to our web, but it is not connected to anything.
So where do you take the information, though, after you take it off of there?
Meaning, take it off of where?
Once you have all the tabulated votes
and
you put it onto a disk, where do you take the disk?
It's loaded onto our county website, which gets uploaded to our webmaster who puts it up on the website.
Okay, and that's all intranet, right? It's a contained network?
Mm-hmm.